How has this writer succeeded? By narrating with great emotional power a single significant incident in her life, the events leading up to it, the climactic moment of decision, and the results of that decision. She has also involved the reader personally in the fortunes of her family by making him identify himself with the chief character, her father.
Although this is a tale of intense spiritual crisis, almost every person's life is charged with inner conflicts and moments of high emotion. But it is the sensitive, creative writer who, by skillfully selecting the most significant events and arranging them in a colorful, dramatic pattern, can infuse them with artistic power. It is such careful selectivity and arrangement that distinguishes a work of literary art from a piece of bare factual reporting. Yet a well-written newspaper account can also be of great service to the writer.
As you scan the columns of your favorite newspaper daily, many items of high dramatic potential for the creative writer leap out at you. Stories of ambition, love, devotion, conflict and violence, dedication and sacrifice, and many other tales of human passion and emotion.
If you are discerning enough, you can often glean from these stories of human interest material for your literary efforts, to furnish you with the nucleus for a current or future story, the model for a character, the spark and inspiration for your thinking. In the story that follows, the writer has selected as a basis for his work a new story of deep human appeal and challenge. Let us see how each developed his choice.
In this work, entitled Marty, the news item on which the story is based is not divulged until the very end. As you listen to the story, see if you can tell why. At the start, two men are reminiscing about Marty, their mutual acquaintance. The story is told through their dialogue.
I hear where old Marty's taken a turn for the worse. Just starving herself to death, won't eat nothing. Known Marty for a long time now. Used to strut around like it was his world, like he owned it all. Darn near did. Yup. He put this old town on the map. Got to be real famous. In those days, he was just about the best flyer around these parts. Any important mail needed delivering, and you know old Marty'd be carrying it. I remember once, during the war, the president himself gave him a decoration. Medal of Honor, or something like it. The highest one. Well, one day, this notice about closing down the run comes out, and old Marty finds himself grounded. Spent his whole life up in the air, and now he's got nowhere to fly. He kind of started dying right then and there. Saw him a few weeks ago and could hardly recognize him.
And didn't know anything else, did he?
No. Seems while he was up flying the mails, the whole world changed underneath him. Guess he feels lost now. Only thing he got left is memories of us older folks remembering who he was and what he done.
I imagine that's what's killing him.
How do you mean?
Well, old Marty just can't face the possibility that all his old admirers might be pitying him. I imagine Marty's too proud to take that, and too wise. He knows what he was, and that memory is all the food and drink he needs to feed what's left of him.
Getting late. Have to be leaving. You going?
Yep.
The two men extinguished the remains of the fire and started home. The next morning, the following news item was printed in the local newspaper. Quote, the world's last passenger pigeon passed away at 1 p.m. on October the 31st, 1914, in the Cincinnati Zoological Gardens. His name was Marty.
The clever whimsy, the element of suspense, and the surprise ending revealing Marty's true identity all make this a most entertaining piece. How has the writer achieved his effect? By working backwards, taking the original news story, speculating about it, and drawing from it the idea for a humorous dialogue between two men discussing an ostensible acquaintance. As for the news item itself, it obviously had to be kept from the reader until the very end.
Although based on fact, Marty, the story we just heard, has all the elements of good, short fiction. The same holds true in the climax of the following short story, based partly on events surrounding the capture of a desperate criminal. The writer has blended fact and his knowledge of technical police operations to create an exciting, fictional piece.
The house where Billings, nationally hunted fugitive, has been hiding has been completely surrounded by the police. Escape seems impossible. Yet as Joe Williams, the detective, watches incredulously, the fugitive makes the attempt. Here is the climax of the detective's short story, The Vigil.
Suddenly, the side door burst open, and there was the fugitive, a .45 automatic in his right hand and something clutched in his left fist. Billings fired once toward Joe and then toward the front. Joe emptied his gun, and the killer collapsed 10 feet away. Joe started forward slowly and then saw a grenade, its spring handle released, roll in a circle from Billings' lifeless hand. In 5 seconds, it would explode. Joe paused as he thought to dive back into the frame vestibule, but the explosive power of the missile would make that move futile. He roared, "Grenade!" rushed ahead and scooped it up. Throw it to the front? To the back? Suddenly, there were officers running toward him from both directions. Hurl it through the doorway window into the house? He might miss the glass, and he'd get only one chance. 3 seconds must have passed, not over 2 remained. A fleet runner could cover 20 yards in that time, or a baseball could be hurled 90 feet. Don't freeze, Joe, he thought to himself. And he grasped the grenade to his chest and flattened himself on the ground. God have mercy, he heard himself say. Suddenly, Joe was spun over onto his back. A big sergeant seized the grenade and hurled it upward like a mortar projectile. It cleared the second floor eaves and landed on the flat roof just before a deafening explosion showered debris into the alleyway. But its force was spent. Joe sobbed, and the sergeant's legs gave out, and he knelt on the ground.